people, lazy and evil. For years I've watched y'all allow Donald Trump turn you to crazy people. Where's that freedom ego when you...
Welcome to Three Count Commentaries. On June 3rd, 2021, I made a video called Stop Worshipping CM Punk. This was before he even came back to quote-unquote professional wrestling. And since coming back, he has maintained that he is an absolute dickhead. And this story, or these two stories that we're going to talk about involving CM Punk being a dickhead after the Revolution pay-per-view, are going to further my thesis that anybody who is a fan of CM Punk in current day is an absolute self-hating bootlicker. So, what am I talking about? Well, CM Punk attacked WWE fans, and then he attacked also a reporter for Meltzer for questioning his Ring of Honor themed entrance at Revolution. So let's talk about the first one first. So we actually have audio of CM Punk at the Revolution press conference after the match, which is very pretentious, by the way. And he says, and I quote, I'm not going to play the audio unless I decide to put the audio in here, which I probably won't, that there's professional wrestling fans, and then there's the weird WWE fans, who, since that's the only thing they've ever seen, they think it's the only thing that has ever existed, and they haven't watched anything else. Here's the situation with that. People know what you're doing exists. It's the internet, CM Punk. You know, I'm sorry to tell you, but most people in today's world do know other wrestling companies exist. They just don't care. I've said 100 times that WWE is Walmart. It is McDonald's. It don't have to be the best, but it's something everybody knows. And then people who do know it tend to mostly enjoy it. And to be quite honest, if your brand of pro wrestling is not working out, it's not because these people are weirdos who never watched anything else. It's because you're a weirdo and insist on being niche. And I want to do a tribute to a match from 1983 because Roddy Piper is my favorite wrestler. It's like, yeah, now you're talking about something people may have never seen. Because a lot of wrestling fans these days are under the age of 35 and having zero interest in watching Starrcade 83. Zero. None. It may be cool when you mention it. Like, oh yeah, this old Roddy Piper and Greg the Hammer Valentine. Very cool match, you know. Maybe you should go watch it. A little bit before my time. There's some fans that are 40 or 50 years old. They don't go back to watching things in the 70s. You know, it depends on what kind of person they are. And I don't think that's weird. I don't think it's weird at all that people shop at Walmart or eat at McDonald's. I don't think it's weird at all. And for over 20 years, other wrestling companies have existed. They've all been small. None of them have been to the level of WWE, and AEW still isn't. So the idea that that's the only thing that they know is like, if your town only has Walmart, you don't know Kmart and Sears and all this other stuff kind of exists, you're not the weirdo. Your town is the weirdo for not having a Kmart. Your town is the weirdo for not having a Sears or not having a Kroger or whatever the case may be. It's not your fault what you're exposed to, right? Now, at the end of the day, what he is talking about here is just another attack on WWE fans. Now, I was asked to talk about the subject of CM Punk not wanting WWE to own his Ring of Honor tapes. And the issue is, I talked about this kind of in the Revolution review. Because I did mention that CM Punk, in the same press conference, says that he doesn't want anything from WWE. And I'm trying to do this from memory because I don't have an article right in front of me. Where he says that he was asking, before he left, he was asking questions about the network. And how was revenue splits and stuff like that going to occur when it comes to the network? And he said that over the years, he saw his royalty checks dwindle down to nothing because he doesn't get paid from the network or he doesn't get paid from the Peacock deal or anything like that. Despite the fact that they have this voluminous amount of content on him. And I would say, like, look, it's an important point to make that, you know, hey, guys who were in the pay-per-view era, that's an important question for them because now it's a big transition. You know, Jim Cornette asked that question. There was a bunch of people who was asking that question. How is the business going to change when you phase out DVDs? How is the business going to change when the things go from, you know, actual physical media to digital media? Now, if this guy, smart guy, actually was, and he says that their response, I feel like I have to put this in there, was that a guy like him will be figured in. He didn't have anything to worry about, but he wanted to know the specifics of it. So the specifics of it is thus: nobody gets paid royalties for streaming. You can go into the SAG, all right? SAG, the Screen Actors Guild. Nobody gets residuals for streaming. Residuals or royalties are paid out upon the reproduction, continued reproduction of the content. Give you an example, WrestleMania. So let's say you're on WrestleMania 20 and you have in your contract that you get a certain percentage off of every reproduction of WrestleMania 20. That means you're going to get paid off of the original distribution of WrestleMania 20. And then you're going to get paid for every additional reproduction of that event. So you get paid again when they make the DVDs. If they make 1,000 DVDs, you get points on every 1,000 DVDs, on every one of those 1,000 DVDs, I should say, singularly, individually. So if you were part of a big event like a WrestleMania, and CM Punk was a part of many of them, and they sold 1 million copies of WrestleMania, that's a pretty big royalty check that he's owed. But if they're getting rid of the WrestleMania DVDs, then those royalty checks will diminish because they're not selling DVDs anymore. So now you have to try to figure out where that money is going to be replaced. Now, what ends up happening from what I know, and this is could be over a year old when it comes to this, so it could have changed. But according to the Screen Actors Guild and a lot of the Hollywood Reporters type websites, Variety and all those, is that you will actually get paid more upfront because the reproduction of your product is not going to occur. So now you would get paid more to do WrestleMania because you're not getting royalties. That's how it will be kind of offset. So when Chris Jericho was talking about he wants royalties from the network, or CM Punk or Jim Cornette and all these guys who say, I want royalties from the network, you're not getting royalties. All right. Now, guys today, they're not going to get royalties from the network. They're going to get royalties from posters, video game. They're going to get, especially physical copies of the video game, all that kind of stuff. Action figures, anything with their name and face on it, they're going to get paid for it. So that's that. But CM Punk isn't producing any new WWE material. And to be quite honest, last I checked, if you were in violation of your contract, one of the first things they do is take your royalties. So CM Punk walked out of WWE in January of 2014. He was gone for 5 months before they fired him. Name me a job that you can walk away from for 5 months before being fired. So the entire idea that he was fired on his wedding day. No, he quit that job 5 months before. Because any other place would have fired you when you no-showed the first fucking event. Or the second event. Or the third event. You would have been fired. They waited 5 months to fucking fire the guy. 5 fucking months. He was sitting around collecting royalties. Collecting money. For 5 fucking months, and he was not coming back to work. So he got fired on his wedding day. So fucking what? Ultimately, that's the story. But nobody talks about how he was sitting around collecting paychecks for 5 fucking months and not actually earning them. So I'm surprised he was still getting royalties at all, considering he was in breach of contract and he could have, or WWE could have, snatched his royalties. Now, because it's a thing that I think they said with, I think it was FTR and some other people. Maybe they changed it after CM Punk did what he did. Where now that's one of the first things they do is if you want to out of your contract, you can sign over your royalty checks or whatever. Sort of to buy your way out of the contract. So it could be different these days. It's hard to tell. Because this was 2014, FTR was in 2020, right? So they probably shifted policy since then. In any event, it's a perfectly reasonable question to say CM Punk wants to get paid for the network. Everybody wants people to get paid for the things that they have earned and things that they worked on. I'm not against that. I'm not against CM Punk being paid his royalties if he's owned royalties. But to be quite honest, nobody gets paid royalties from the network because of how the structure of the networking goes. Will Smith, if he makes a movie for Netflix, he doesn't get any royalties off of that unless they port it over to DVD, which sometimes they do. You know, people don't believe that. Like, I was in Walmart the other day. I saw Survivor Series on DVD. So that means there's guys getting Survivor Series royalty paychecks because they were on Survivor Series and they're making physical copies of it. It's not many, but they're still making them. So, yes, sometimes a Netflix TV show will be ported over to DVD. And then the actor or whatever will get royalties off of that. But you don't get royalties for straight to streaming content. It doesn't occur that way. You get paid more upfront because you're not going to get paid royalties. Now to that point, I'm finally getting to the point of the subscriber. CM Punk thinks apparently that, you know, because of that whole thing, he doesn't want WWE owning the Ring of Honor tapes. If he thinks he's going to get royalties from the Ring of Honor tapes, he's wrong. Tony Khan has to be an absolute mark to give him royalties. Him and Danielson and Samoa Joe and all those guys, to give those guys royalties. You know, because technically they don't have to. You know, now he can make DVDs, Tony Khan. If he wants to make DVDs and then they get paid off the DVDs, that's smart business. He should do that. You know, help these guys make as much money as they can, because obviously they're crybabies. Well, CM Punk is a crybaby, and if you own the library and you don't do anything and pay him for it, he's going to go to the media and complain. And plus, it's just good business to make documentaries and do different things that feature him so that he can get paid and he can shut the fuck up, you know. But if they get a streaming deal, let's say HBO Max, Apple TV, or whatever, he's not going to get paid off that either. And if he thinks that he is, he's a fucking fool. It's not going to happen. Nobody, not Will Smith, not The Rock, not Dave Bautista, and certainly not CM Punk, is going to get royalties off of streaming because it's too difficult to figure out how, you know, now I think now they're finally starting to keep track of who watches what and how long they watch it and everything. So maybe that will change. You know, maybe in the future, somebody will say, well, now that we can track how many times somebody accesses a stream, we can get paid off of that stream, you know, maybe. But it's the same thing with music. Music was a lot more profitable when it was physical copies of music than it is on the Spotify and stuff like that. Because now they get, you know, small amounts of money per stream or something like that. So maybe that's kind of what they'll do, you know, in the future. And they're always working on this stuff. So if my information is out of date or if my information is, you know, a little askew, it could have changed in the last time that I looked at it. But I did a video several months ago on Chris Jericho talking about he wanted network royalties. And I explained in that video why nobody gets network royalties and it wasn't going to happen. So maybe it's changed since then. I don't keep my finger on that, on the pulse of that. I just wanted to understand it. And now I think I got the general idea. But if guys like The Rock keep making movies for Netflix, they're getting paid a grip and they don't care about royalties. You know, or, you know, they have in their contract that they'll make a certain number of DVDs or something like that, which I guess you could do. With a certain number of wrestlers, you could, you know, agree to make DVDs. Then, you know, that might be different. But as far as I know, nobody gets paid royalties off of this stuff. And it's likely nobody will be, you know, because it's very hard. And you could put these streaming platforms in a lot of debt by doing that, which is why they don't have it. You know, Netflix loses a lot of money as is. Almost all the streaming services right now are losing money. Almost all of them. Disney Plus, Peacock, Netflix, almost all of them are losing money. Because they pay so much for premium content, and then you're asking people essentially to go into cable all over again. Because these things are getting more and more expensive. They used to be like $9.99 or $5.99. Now they're $12, $13, $14, you know. And if you had to pay royalties to every actor that appears on a television show, my God, just imagine if you were on something like The Simpsons and you're Disney and you have to pay these actors who have been on The Simpsons for 20 years. You have to continually pay them over. They'll take The Simpsons off the fucking site because it'll crash them financially. Law and Order SVU. would kill NBC. Mariska Hargitay would fucking own NBC if they had to give her royalties off of every stream of Law and Order SVU. You know, she's been on the fucking show for 30 fucking years. It's entirely too much. You have to think about that in terms of being a business. You know, I'm pretty sure she gets a nice little deal. And then there's still syndication money. So she's not going to be broke. And none of these people will be. But the way that the streaming stuff is set up is very, very difficult to manage. And then, or your points are going to be very low. Which, you know, I think that's what it is in music, is that the points are very, very low. So I went into a rant about that. The second thing I really wanted to talk about was the Paul Fontaine tweet. So Paul Fontaine is a reporter for Wrestling Observer Newsletter, F4W Online. So Paul Fontaine was watching AEW Revolution, and he says, "What am I missing with this CM Punk entrance?" CM Punk responded, "A deep understanding of storytelling, a brain." And Paul Fontaine responds, "I understand the story. I had never seen that part of your ROH career. Now that it's been explained to me, it's really awesome for those people that did. This whole storyline has been my favorite feud I've seen in over 2 decades, and I've said that many times." CM Punk then deleted his tweet. That means that unless you kiss his ass, you lack a deep understanding of storytelling, and you lack a brain. Wow. Tremendous. And this is an ass kisser that he's talking to here. "Oh, this is my favorite feud. I've been watching for 2 decades. Fuck both of these guys. This is the absolute state of wrestling journalism. A wrestling journalist is attacked out of nowhere by CM Punk, gets absolutely ratioed and dunked on. And then this guy comes back with, instead of calling him out for being a dickhead and saying, "Hey, look, even if I've been a wrestling fan for 20 years, that doesn't mean I've watched every obscure Ring of Honor tape ever. Hell, I watched Ring of Honor. I've seen it. I wasn't dedicated to it because it came on at like 2 o'clock in the fucking morning. All right. And then for me to remember some shit from 20 years ago. And then here's the crazy thing. The story that we're telling had nothing to do with Ring of Honor. Not one motherfucking thing. Not one. Remember, he sat in the ring and said, "Will you be my Valentine?" He was talking about Roddy Piper, Valentine, Starrcade 83. That was what the storyline was based on. Now it's changed to his Ring of Honor dog collar match with Raven. It's like, okay, not everybody saw that. Not everybody know that. It's okay to not know things, motherfucker. Why you have to go? And this is the thing. The guy didn't even at CM Punk. That's the crazy thing. He didn't add him. CM Punk vanity searched his name, found this guy, and then dunked on him. And then the guy retaliated, absolutely kissing his ass. I can't believe it. Stop worshiping this man, dog. Y'all need to stop it. No, I can say this because I don't have fans. I have supporters. If at any point I just start randomly dunking on people because I'm getting defensive, I expect people who have been following this channel for a little while to call me out on it and say, "Look, man, it's not even you." At most, ignore it. If the guy didn't understand it, other people will explain it. You don't need to go after the guy and dunk on him and try to embarrass him in public. You don't have to do that. It's corny as fuck, and it doesn't make you look good. But this defensive sack of shit attacked this guy. And look, weakness only invites more aggression. So when this guy weakly responded, "I've been saying it's my favorite feud," all he had to do was be like, "Bitch, I don't remember that. Even if I saw it, I don't remember it." It's not like you've been talking about it for 4 fucking months. You've been in this feud talking about WWE. You didn't mention Ring of Honor once until fucking Tony Khan bought it. Come on, man. Get the fuck out of here. This is some bullshit. This is the absolute state of wrestling journalism. The absolute state of independent wrestling mindset. This shit is ridiculous. And this is how he treats his ass kissers. So we've seen how he treats people who criticize him. They're weirdos who never seen anything else. How is that? Maybe they did and they didn't like it. You know, just because people eat at McDonald's don't mean they don't know Burger King exists. It means they chose to eat McDonald's. That's what it means. You know, Wendy's still exists. Everybody has their little picadillos. Some people like a little bit of Ring of Honor. Some people like a little TNA. Some people liked a little bit of House of Glory or Defy or whatever podunk promotion that you supported. There's a lot of people who like a little bit of that stuff. OVW, MLW, a lot of that stuff. But those people also watch a lot of WWE. And there's enough people who watch WWE. And to be quite honest, and I'm going to close with this. To be quite honest, the people who criticize him mostly are people who were WWE fans and were hoping AEW was good. Because the real hardcore WWE fans, a lot of the people with the Roman Reigns avatars or the Sasha Banks and Becky Lynch avatars, they don't really engage with you like that. They may be WWE fans, but they don't talk about CM Punk. They don't talk about AEW. They talk about what they like, which is why, you know, that would, if you have a women's avatar and you're a guy, that's pretty weird. And some of those guys are like that. But I don't see a lot of those guys really getting involved with AEW. They talk about mostly their own thing, their waifus, wrestling waifus or whatever. Those guys don't really, you know, get involved or get into trolling wars with Ring of Honor fans or AEW fans. A lot of those guys don't. So I'm not saying that there are no weird WWE fans. They are. The Sasha Banks fan base, the Io Shirai fan base. But a lot of those guys are not going to criticize CM Punk out of nowhere for no reason, knowing that they haven't seen it. Because a lot of those guys are teenagers, and this stuff occurred probably before they was even born. So CM Punk is a fucking weirdo. He's a moron. He's a dickhead. And for some reason, y'all keep sucking up to him. Stop it.